But first, the spectacular falling out between Anthony Albanese and Joel Fitzgibbon over energy and climate change should not obscure the fact that much the same divisions exist on both sides of politics. Of course, Fitzgibbon is right. Where elections have been fought over the climate change issue, like 2013 and again last year, well, the Labor Party has lost because prosperity and jobs in the here and now are at least as important as speculative fears about the impact of rising emissions three decades away. But don't think that the emissions obsession is confined to Labor and the Green Left. It's a real problem for the Liberal Party too, especially at state level. And today burst out into the open the divisions with Federal Energy Minister Angus Taylor's attack on his New South Wales counterpart Matt Keane, dubbed Matt Green, by many of his internal Liberal Party critics. Now, the basic problem here is not left versus right. It's people who can afford to be woke versus people who have to be practical. There are virtue signalers in both parties, and almost the guarantee that economically ruinous change is coming is any policy from a Liberal government that has Labor support. And don't think it's only happening in Australia either. The same fault lines exist in British politics as well, with Labor finally moving back to the centre under Keir Starmer, while Boris Johnson is repeating David Cameron's green folly by promising to ban petrol and diesel-powered cars by 2030, as if that's going to hold the blue-collar Tories who voted for him after Brexit, but whom he almost seems determined now to let go as he pushes on with a very inner Sydney, inner London green sort of deal. That's why Angus Taylor is right to be concerned about the latest offering from the New South Wales government, which even the Greens are backing. I mean, that in itself should be a sign that Keane is off the reservation. Because any policy backed by the Greens, it's not a policy in my view, that's worthy of the Liberal name. In a little over 2 years from now, the giant Liddell coal-fired power station that produces about 15% of New South Wales power is due to close. Of course, if the Tomago aluminium smelter nearby closes with it because it can no longer access the baseload power it needs to stay open and takes thousands of direct and indirect jobs, well, that'll be no problem, people like Keane would tell you. Because there's a real dishonesty at the heart of the energy debate. The claim that we can have more and more intermittent renewable energy without also losing the heavy industry that requires 24/7 power. Keane says that the Liddell closure is no big deal. And he cites modelling purporting to show that more renewables, even renewables firmed by batteries and pumped hydro, that they mean cheaper power. As is so often the case with assertions like that, the modelling, he says, is there to justify it. Well, the modelling from Matt Keane has not been published. Now, Angus Taylor, of course, is far from sure. And he's demanded that Keane make the modelling available, at least to the federal government, so it can be properly scrutinised. He cites Victorian modelling a little while back that said that the closure of the giant Hazelwood coal-fired power station in 2017, Labor's modelling, they said it would have negligible impact, when in fact, Angus Taylor's right to remind us, it led to a doubling of the wholesale power in Victoria. The basic split is between those who still support fossil fuels for baseload power, particularly gas, which is about half the emissions of coal, and those who have adopted a slightly milder version of Extinction Rebellion, seeing all fossil fuels as a threat to the survival of the planet. Naturally, the Apocalypse Soon Brigade, they keep citing other countries and some companies' supposed commitments to be carbon neutral by 2050, as if anyone should believe commitments made by this crop of virtue-signalling politicians and business leaders, because they'll all fall to their successors 10-plus federal elections later to deliver. Naturally, embittered ex-PM Malcolm Turnbull is chiming in on the side of Albanese, Matt Keane and the Greens. And this is the same Turnbull, let's not forget, who lost the leadership twice trying to get the Liberals to adopt the Labor Party's energy policy and who now accuses his former colleagues of pursuing energy idiocy at the behest of Rupert Murdoch.
Frankly, the less we hear from the federal government on energy, possibly the better, because they've got nothing constructive to add at the moment. I mean, the gas-led recovery is honestly a mirage. We have seen the consequences of global warming at their most apocalyptic in Australia last summer. Fundamentally, the problem is a political one inside the coalition. It is that toxic troika of right-wing populism, right-wing media, and the fossil fuel lobby.
And he was there, I might add, with Tim Flannery at a Get Up Energy Symposium. Well, discount modelling, that's my tip. It's only about as realistic as the assumptions on which modelling's based. Look at the facts instead. Everywhere it's happened, whether it's in South Australia, the UK or parts of Europe, big jumps in renewable power have led to big jumps in energy prices. That's because all renewables need to be backed up by fossil fuels, at least for the next few decades. 15 years on from the first mandated use of renewable energy in this country, wind and solar still require heavy subsidies to stack up. Have a listen the next time you hear anyone spruik renewables. In almost the same breath as they claim renewables are cheaper than coal or gas, they insist that subsidies are still needed to drive the so-called market. And so far, the only impact of Matt Keane's energy roadmap has been to cause AGL to rethink its investment in a new gas plant in the Hunter and for Energy Australia to rethink its new gas plant in the Illawarra. And all of that means less reliability and less affordability, not more, and more question marks over the future of our homegrown steel and aluminium industries and the tens of thousands of jobs they sustain. Not to mention the national security implications if we're forced to rely on foreign suppliers for everything needed to sustain manufacturing in this country. Now, I wish I could say that energy policy is in good hands with the Liberal Party, but I can't. Because right now, it entirely depends on whether it's a Angus Taylor type or a Matt Keane calling the shots. Labor might be fighting a fairly public war for the soul of the blue-collar worker, but don't think the coalition are immune. In both fights, I can only hope that environmental sense is balanced with sound economics over the obsessions of the inner-city green zealots that live happily inside both of the major two parties.